Grace to you in peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Good evening and welcome to the first annual Nevin Lectures. We're grateful that you all have come and we hope this weekend will be edifying to you. I'm Peter Lightheart, president of Trinity House Institute for Biblical, Liturgical, and Cultural Studies, which is sponsoring this event. Trinity House was founded in 2012 to promote the reformation of the church by training pastors, future pastors, and lay people in scripture and liturgical theology. We believe that the church exists for the life of the world. The waters flow out of the Edenic sanctuary to the four corners of the earth. Through water and word, in a feast of bread and wine, the Spirit of Jesus shapes us into God's agents to transfigure creation from glory to glory. So by fostering reformation in the church, we also hope to contribute to the renewal of culture. Currently, we do this primarily by hosting several courses each year, each of which is an intensive week of instruction, worship, fellowship, and conversation. Our next class on the topic of holistic mission will be taught by Wes Baker, a longtime PCA missionary in Peru. And the back cover, inside the back cover of your program, there's an advertisement for this class, which also shows you the website if you want to get more information or if you should wish to register for that class. The registration form is online at our website. If you have questions about Trinity House over the course of the weekend, please find me and ask me questions. Also, you can talk to Joe Crawford, if you would stand, Joe. Joe's behind the camera at the moment. He's the Executive Vice President of Trinity House, and he can help answer questions about what we do and about classes and so on, should you have any. It's our conviction that no deformation of Christ's body is as tragic as our disfiguring fragmentation as a church. Nothing has mutilated the gospel so much as our uncharitable divisions. So Trinity House Institute's commitment to reformation includes a commitment to promoting the Catholic unity among the people of God. Hence these Nevin Lectures. The lecture series is named for John Williamson Nevin, a 19th century American theologian and educator who, along with the church historian Philip Schaff, developed what came to be known as the Mercersburg theology. Nevin was, in the words of historian Daryl Hart, a high church Calvinist dedicated to nurturing Catholic unity within the body of Christ. And if you wish to know more about Nevin, I refer you to the Mercersburg theology series. There's some flyers out in the lobby. This is a series of texts written by John Williamson Nevin and Philip Schaff, being edited by Brad Littlejohn and published by Wippenstock, if you want to learn more about Nevin and Schaff and their work. In an 1844 sermon on Ephesians 4, Nevin declared that the unity of the church is a cardinal truth in the Christian system. It's involved in the very conception of Christian salvation itself. When we lose sight of the unity of the church, he said, we make shipwreck of the gospel. This unity can't remain merely inward and invisible. It must appear externally in the world. If the church is one in its essence, then she should be unified also in an outward and visible way. One body is the normal character of the church, and anything less, Nevin said, is a serious defect. Any honest assessment, Nevin said, must conclude that the church, most especially in America, is seriously defective. Our various sects, as they actually exist, he said, are an immense evil in the church. Whatever may be said of the possibility of their standing in friendly correspondence and stimulating the whole body to a more vigorous life, it is certain that they mar the unity of Christ's body in fact, and deprive it of its proper beauty and strength. Our sects, as they actually stand at this time, are a vast reproach to the Christian cause. By no possibility could they be countenanced and approved as good by the Lord Jesus Christ, if he should appear again in the world as the visible head of his people. Nevin acknowledged that the wounds in the body of Christ can't be healed through crusades or programs. The first step is for Christians to lay to heart the evil that is comprehended in the actual disunion and division of the church, to lament the calamity of a fractured body of Christ. Nevin himself lamented the fact that the church's disunity was not sufficiently lamented. What is most deplorable, he said, is that so many should be willing to acquiesce in disunity as something necessary and never to be changed. And what is most needed in these circumstances is that anxiety and concern should take the place of such indifference, and that men should be brought to acknowledge openly the reigning wrong of these divisions in the church and to inquire earnestly after some way of escape. Yet Nevin remained hopeful. Reflecting on Jesus' prayer in John 17, he said that the present order of the church cannot be the final order of the church. And he looked ahead to a time when the prayer of Christ, that the church may become one, will appear gloriously fulfilled in its actual character and state throughout the whole world. We must wait on God. But Nevin said, waiting is not inaction. He called on Christians to cultivate Christian charity in the bosom of the church itself. It is the unity of the church, he said. It is the duty of the church, he said, to observe and improve all opportunities by which it is made possible in any measure from time to time to advance in a visible way the interest of Catholic unity. Whatever can serve in any way to bring together the moral dispersions of the house of Israel must be counted worthy of the most earnest regard. These Nevin lectures are, we trust, one of these opportunities. Echoing Nevin's lament, but also animated by Nevin's hope, this lecture series will provide an annual venue for honest, theologically serious, charitable conversation and debate about the issues that divide us. We, of course, have no illusions that we can solve the divisions of centuries in four lectures over a single weekend. But we're encouraged by Nevin's observation. He said, every instance in which the open correspondence and communion of particular sections of the church is made to assume a more intimate character than it had before deserved to be hailed as an approximation toward the unity which the whole body is destined finally to reach. The Nevin Lecture Series is a small step, but even the smallest step can nurture what Nevin thought most needful, an inward sympathy and agreement between the parties it brings together. With these thoughts in mind, I want to invite Pastor Rich Lusk, the host pastor here at Trinity Presbyterian Church, to welcome you and also to open our lectures in prayer. Dr. George is founding dean of Beeson Divinity School here in Birmingham, where he also teaches church history and doctrine. He has written over 20 books, including The Theology of the Reformers. He is general editor of the Reformation Commentary on Scripture and serves on the editorial board of the Harvard Theological Review. Outside the academy, he is chairman of the board of the Colson Center for Christian Worldview. He chairs the Doctrine and Christian Unity Commission for the Baptist World Alliance. He is a senior theological advisor for Christianity Today, and he's on the editorial advisory board of First Things Magazine. For our purposes this weekend, Dr. George's commitment to Christian unity is what particularly stands out. He has created a uniquely ecumenical faculty and atmosphere at Beeson Divinity School and has long been a leader in evangelical Catholic dialogue. In the 1844 sermon I mentioned earlier, Nevin said that the union of the church is not to be established by stratagem or force. To be valid, it must be free, the spontaneous product of Christian knowledge and Christian love. Timothy George exemplifies the spirit of Nevin's vision, and it's a great pleasure and privilege for us to welcome him as our first Nevin lecturer. His first lecture this evening is entitled Recovering the Baptismal Theology of the Early Church. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Timothy George.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lightheart. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to say it's a great privilege to be here to present these inaugural Nevin Lectures. When I heard about the Trinity Institute's beginning about a year or so ago, I rejoiced in my heart that it was so, and that Birmingham, Alabama, would be the locale for this ministry that will reach far beyond our city and state, indeed, we trust, around the world. And to be a part of this inaugural lectureship is a great blessing and privilege. Thank you for asking me to do it. Now, because the overall theme of this year's Nevin Lectures is sacramental theology from a Baptist perspective, I need to say something about my own tradition and its location within the ecumenical space in which this conversation is taking place. First, I am an ordained minister in the Southern Baptist Convention and have been so since I was 20 years of age. Now, it will come as no surprise to most of you that the majority of Southern Baptists would find the words sacramental and ecumenical equally unhelpful and even deplorable. But while I recognize myself as a Protestant, an evangelical, and a Baptist, none of these labels defines my spiritual and ecclesial identity at its most basic level. Being an evangelical Protestant, a Baptist, indeed a Southern Baptist, are all important markers of my place within the community of faith, but there is a more primary confession I must make. By God's grace, I am a Trinitarian Christian who belongs to the whole company of the redeemed through the ages. Those who are very members incorporate in the mystical body of Christ, as the Book of Common Prayer puts it. Now, far from being a new construal, this way of putting things goes to the very heart of what it means to be a genuine Protestant, a true evangelical, and an authentic Baptist. Central to each of these commitments is a desire to be faithful to the scripture-based apostolic witness of the early church. When Polycarp of Smyrna, a disciple of the Apostle John, was brought before the Roman tribunal before being cast into the arena with a wild beast, he confessed publicly the faith which he knew would lead to his certain martyrdom. In that critical moment, Polycarp did not say, "I am a Paulinist, I am a Petrist, or I am a Johannian." Neither did he say, I am an Ignatian, after his great contemporary Ignatius of Antioch, nor I am an Irenaean, after his famous disciple, Irenaeus of Lyon. Rather, he confessed, "Christianus sum," I am a Christian. Yet the desire for a mere Christianity, mere in the weak, attenuated sense of mere, that is, barely, hardly, minimally, carries its own risks. And so I find myself here today identified with and declaring myself to be a part of those Christians who are called Baptists. Why am I a Baptist? I am a Baptist because it was through the witness of a small Baptist church that I first heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. Many of the things I still believe in, I first learned in that modest Baptist community of faith. That Jesus loves me and died on the cross for my sins. That the Bible is the totally truthful and trustworthy Word of God. That all human beings are made in the image of God and precious in His sight. It was through the loving nurture I received from that congregation that I confessed my personal faith in Jesus as Savior and Lord of my life. I was then baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. When I was called to preach, it was in a Baptist church that I was set apart and ordained as a minister of the divine word. It is important to say that all of this came to me as a gift from beyond myself. It is not as though I had studied carefully and weighed objectively every religious possibility before committing myself to the Baptist cause. My experience was rather of a person who finds himself standing, waiting, and eventually swimming in a flowing mountain stream. Later, as I studied the Bible more deeply and became aware of many other church traditions, doctrines, and denominations, my Baptist convictions grew stronger. I gradually came to understand the meaning of what I believed. Fides querens intellectum, faith in search of understanding, a quest that continues still. I came to see that being a Baptist was the most faithful way I could be an evangelical, a Protestant, and a Christian. But this has not stifled my desire to be in dialogue with and to learn from Christians of many different ilks. I once prepared a talk called The Confessions of a Catholic Friendly, Pentecostal Admiring, Reformed Baptist with a Hankering After Lutheranism and a Strong Affinity for the Book of Common Prayer. If I'm not mistaken, such an attitude would not be too far from the spirit and ecclesial sensitivity of John Williamson Nevin, for whom this lectureship is named, and his great Mercersburg colleague, Philip Schaff, both of whom I shall have something to say about in my final presentation. But before we get to Nevin and Schaff, we have a lot of ground to cover. So let's jump right in to this evening's topic, recovering the baptismal theology of the early church. I want to look at baptism from the early church from three different angles. First, its confessional character. Next, its liturgical context. And finally, its pastoral and spiritual consequences. I'm not sure I'll get to the third, but I hope so. But as this is to be a Baptist perspective, as the title of your program indicates, I want to begin with two baptism stories. One from the early church, from Cyprian, in the period we are most concerned about, the 3rd century. The other from the 19th century London Baptist pastor, Charles Haddon Spurgeon. First Cyprian. His testimony comes from a first-person letter written to a new convert in 246 AD, not long after his own conversion and baptism, and several years before he was chosen as the Bishop of Carthage. "I promise to share with you," he wrote, "the grace God in His great mercy has shown me, and to tell you as simply as I can what I have experienced since I was baptized. Up until that time, I was still living in the dark, knowing nothing of my true life. I was completely involved in this world's affairs, influenced by all its changing moods and troubles, and exiled from the light of truth. I had indeed been told that God offered men and women a second birth by which we could be saved, but I very much doubted that I could change the kind of life I was then living. My past was so burdened with so many sins that I saw no way ever to get rid of, that I had grown accustomed to giving way to my weakness. I despaired of ever doing any better. But at last I made up my mind to ask for baptism. I went down into those life-giving waters and all the stains of my past were washed away. I committed my life to the Lord. He cleansed my heart and filled it with His Holy Spirit. I was born again, a new man. And then, in a most marvelous way, all my doubts cleared up. I could now see what had been hidden from me before. I found that I could do things that previously had been impossible. We have received the seal of the Holy Spirit. Our task is now to preserve the integrity of what we have received by living a truly Christian life. We must give time to prayer, to the study of the Scripture. Now speaking to God, now listening to His Word to us, now letting His teaching mold us, He has enriched us with a treasure no one can take away." Cyprian. Now to Spurgeon. Spurgeon was baptized in the River Lark on May the 3rd, 1850, just shy of his 16th birthday. And he left us this testimony. I was up early to have a couple of hours for quiet prayer and dedication to God. I then had some 8 miles to walk to reach the spot where I was to be immersed into the triune name according to the sacred command. What a walk it was. What thoughts and prayers thronged my soul during that morning's journey. It was by no means a warm day, and therefore all the better for the 2 or 3 hours of quiet foot travel, which I enjoyed. I went to church that day, but my thoughts were in the water. Sometimes with my Lord in joy, sometimes with myself in trembling awe at making so public a confession. The wind blew down the river with a cutting blast as my turn came to wade into the flood. But after I had walked a few steps and noted the people on the ferry boat and in boats on either shore, I felt as if heaven and earth and hell might all gaze upon me, for I was not ashamed then and there to own myself a follower of the Lamb. My timidity was washed away. It floated down the river into the sea, and it must have been devoured by the fishes, for I have never felt anything of that kind since. Baptism also loosed my tongue, and from that day it has never been quiet. I lost 1,000 fears in the river Lark and found that in keeping His commandment, there is great reward. Spurgeon's mother was a Congregationalist Christian and not entirely keen on her 16-year-old son's step of faith that led to this public baptism. And when he got home, he told her what had happened to him and that he had been baptized. She said, "I've been praying for you, but I didn't want you to join the Baptists." And he responded, "My dear mother, the Lord has given you more than you prayed for." Now, what hath Cyprian to do with Spurgeon? Or the Baptisterium, if that is what it was called in Carthage, with the River Lark? The personal testimony of baptism and its transforming effects on one's life, both Cyprian's and Spurgeon's, is related to what I'm calling in this lecture the confessional character of baptism, its doctrinal content, which is the most prominent feature of baptism in the Christian communities of the early church. The Trinitarian character of God is first clearly glimpsed in the New Testament at Jesus' baptism in the Jordan by John the Baptist. All three synoptic gospels describe Jesus' baptism in some detail, and Luke places it within the chronological sweep of world history, beginning with Adam, coming up to the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being the governor of Judea, and Herod being the tetrarch of Galilee, Luke says. While John the Baptist may have known about religious washings and ablutions of various kind practiced in the community of Qumran and elsewhere within Second Temple Judaism, his baptismal practice stood out from all of these. Like baptism in the early church, it was unrepeatable, done once and for all. John's baptismal ministry links the old and new covenants, or as Calvin was wont to think of it, the one covenant in two dispensations. But it also represents something unique and unheard of before, something directly related to the person who stands in the Jordan waiting to be baptized. That Jesus would come to John asking for what is called a baptism with water for repentance demands explanation. Matthew places our question on John's lips. "I am the one who should be baptized by you. Why do you come to me?" The reply of Jesus, which raises more questions than it answers, is simply, "It is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Jesus enters the watery grave of baptism on our behalf as our substitute, if you will, just as later He will take our place on the cross, dying a God-forsaken death for God-forsaken sinners. Our substitute in both cases. But water symbolizes not only death, but also life. As Paul made clear in Romans 6:4, the New Testament verse quoted more than any other in Baptist baptismal services. We were buried, therefore, with Him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Pope Benedict XVI expressed it this way: to accept the invitation to be baptized now means to go to the place of Jesus' baptism. It is to go where He identifies Himself with us and to receive there our identification with Him. The point where He anticipates death has now become the point where we anticipate rising again with Him. In this event, Jesus' baptism reveals to us the mystery of the Trinitarian, the triune God. Of course, Jesus' entire life and ministry does the same, as Matthew makes clear in Jesus' post-Easter commissioning of His disciples in Matthew 28:19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. But at Jesus' baptism, the revelation of the triune God is made known in a dramatic way. Three things happen. First, as Jesus comes up out of the water, there was a disturbance in the sky above. Most of our modern English translations follow the Latin here rather than the Greek. The Latin says, "Vidit caelus apertos." He saw the heavens open. But the Greek is stronger than that. Mark uses the word schizomenos, which literally means abruptly torn apart, split wide open, suddenly ripped in two. The brass ceiling between heaven and earth has been shattered. No longer are human beings enclosed in upon themselves, imprisoned in an empty world, unable to breathe the air of eternity. Rather, Jesus at His baptism has split open the heavens, just as at His death He will rip through the veil in the temple. Now the meaning of His baptism as His birth becomes clear. Emmanuel, God is with us. Second, the descent of the Spirit who comes, it says, like a dove. In the baptismal liturgy of the early church, this will be spelled out more explicitly in the anointing or chrism, the seal of baptism. We'll come to that hopefully in a few minutes. And finally, I said three things. Finally, there is the voice of the Heavenly Father telling us not what Jesus is doing or what He will do, but actually who He is. My Son, the Beloved One. Hear Him. Listen to Him. Those who imagine that the doctrine of the Trinity was invented out of whole cloth by Plato-intoxicated theologians in the 4th century have not read deeply or believed the baptismal credo found in many New Testament texts, such as Ephesians 4:4-6. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope at your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. As we read these texts, it becomes clear that baptism in the early church was both a personal profession of faith and also a community-forming event. At the heart of this mystery, the Latin sacramentum, is the Christian affirmation of the one triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, I want us in just a second to drop in on a baptismal service that might have taken place, say, around 230 or 250, around the time of Cyprian's baptism. Let us look, though, before we get there, to how baptism reinforced the emerging rule of faith during the tumultuous second century, when the extent of the canon was being debated and the church found itself in the midst of a ferocious fight for its very soul. I'm referring to that noxious brew of Oriental mysticism, cosmic and apocalyptic speculation, and Greek philosophical theories, all suffused with biblical motifs and Christian imagery that we call Gnosticism. Gnosticism was not so much a movement as it was a mood. It was multivalent and pluriform, organized into diverse churches, sects, systems of thoughts, ascetic communities. For many years, we only knew about the Gnostic teachings from a few early Christian heresiologists, including Irenaeus, Tertullian, and a little later Epiphanius. But in 1946, a stunning discovery of a cache of ancient Gnostic texts was found at Nag Hammadi in the Upper Nile region of Egypt. They have now been translated and published, and we can read at least some of the Gnostics in their own words. This discovery, along with the Dead Sea Scrolls, at about the same time, have given us a much more textured view of orthodoxy and heresy in the early church. We should not think of these Gnostic groupings as a kind of these Gnostic groups as a kind of New Agey chat club led by Oprah or Shirley MacLaine. No, they proclaimed a rival gospel and established rival churches with their own liturgy, bishop, and baptism. One of these groups was called the Marcosians, after their leader Marcus, who was a disciple of the Gnostic teacher Valentinus. At the heart of their theology was a dichotomized Redeemer, Jesus separated from Christ. Jesus was a Jewish man who appeared in Palestine as an itinerant rabbi. Christ, on the other hand, was a secret messenger of the alien Father. The real Christ, the Gnostics said, had passed through Mary's womb like water through a pipe and then descended on the man Jesus at his baptism by John in the Jordan. The visible baptism of Jesus in the real, wet, perhaps even muddy water of Jordan was nugatory. What mattered was the invisible, spiritual baptism granted to those elect souls trapped in bodies of mortal flesh. Salvation for them was by gnosis, not pistis, by knowledge, not faith. Gnosis was the secret esoteric knowledge passed on within the Gnostic church by means of incantations, chants, various rituals, including a counterfeit baptism. Irenaeus tells us that the Marcosians would lead their disciples to a place where water is and baptize them with the utterance of these words: into the name of the unknown Father of the universe, into truth, the mother of all things, into him who descended on Jesus, into union and redemption and communion with the powers, I baptize you. Still others, Irenaeus tells us, dispensed with water altogether. Instead, they mixed oil and water together and placed this mixture on the heads of those who were to be initiated. Still others performed baptism with neither oil nor water, maintaining that the mystery of the unspeakable and invisible power ought not to be performed by visible and corruptible creatures. Instead, they believed that the knowledge of the unspeakable greatness is itself perfect redemption. My friend Dr. Jeff Bingham, who teaches at Wheaton College, has noted that immediately following Irenaeus' description of the Gnostics and their perverted baptismal practices, the great teacher Irenaeus provides an exposition of the regula veritatis, the rule of faith, the rule of truth. After quoting Peter's sermon on the day of Pentecost in Acts 2, he concludes with Acts 2:38, "Repent, be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." After quoting that Irenaeus said this: "Thus the apostles did not preach another God or another fullness, nor that the Christ who suffered and rose again was one, while he who flew off on high was another, Jesus Christ. But that there was one and the same God the Father in Christ Jesus who rose from the dead." And if you're familiar with the history of creeds in the early church, you will recall that this phrase, "one and the same," appears again and again and again, like the tolling of a bell. One and the same. In the early church, then, baptismal theology and creedal orthodoxy were coherent. They emerged together in a pattern of mutual reinforcement that enabled the church to withstand the attacks of the Gnostics and other heretics and to pass on the faith intact to the rising generation. Okay. Now I'm coming to the second part of my talk, the liturgical context of baptism in the early church. In many American evangelical churches today, the practice of baptism has become marginalized and routinized in a way that belies its confessional character and its centrality in the community of faith. What would you have seen had you stumbled onto a Christian baptism service in the early church around the year 230 AD? One way to answer this question would be to do an in-depth analysis of baptism at one particular locale. But for the purposes of this talk, I've chosen a somewhat broader approach, drawing on a number of liturgical documents in both East and West. I want to describe what I'm calling the 12-step baptismal process of the early church, a new 12-step program. And I'll be drawing particularly on three documents, though bringing others in as well. The three are Tertullian's treatise, De Baptismo, on baptism, from the early 3rd century, Carthage, North Africa. The document known as the Apostolic Tradition, usually attributed to Hippolytus around 215 in Rome, though it's likely a composite document from later in the century, but clearly reflecting baptismal practices that had been going on for some time. And, third document, Cyril of Jerusalem's catechetical lectures from around 348, just a little bit later, cheating a little bit with Cyril to get in the East. In this way, we can get a synoptic summary of what baptism might have looked like in Carthage, Rome, or Jerusalem, sometime between 250 and 350 AD. So here's the 12-step baptismal process. One, preparation. On a quick reading of Acts 2, it appears that the 3,000 at Pentecost who heard Peter's message responded with repentance and faith and were baptized, and they did so on the spot with little, if any, pre-baptismal instruction. And the same is true of other baptisms in Acts, such as that of the Ethiopian eunuch, whom Philip the deacon intercepted on the road from Jerusalem to Gaza. Here, at least, there was some exegetical instruction, as Philip, beginning with Isaiah 53, told him the good news of Jesus, as Luke puts it. But this mini-sermon by Philip could not have lasted too long, for as the text says, as they went along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What is to prevent my being baptized?" In some, but not all, ancient manuscripts, there is this exchange. And Philip said, "If you believe with all your heart, you may." And he replied, "I believe that Jesus is the Son of God." Whereupon the chariot was stopped. They both went down into the water, the text says, and Philip baptized the eunuch. But as many have pointed out, most of those baptized in Acts were either Jews from the diaspora or Gentile God-fearers who knew well the overarching storyline of the Hebrew Scriptures. In any event, as the church moves from the early communities gathered by the apostles and their immediate followers out into the wider Greco-Roman world, marked by rampant paganism and religious pluralism, just think of the mystery religions, the church found it necessary to prepare candidates for baptism through a deliberate and sometimes lengthy process known as the catechumenate. This is because baptism was serious business, and it was necessary for the new Christians to understand what they were getting into. In an almost lyrical passage, Cyril of Jerusalem has this to say about the rite of Christian initiation in Jerusalem. "Great indeed is the baptism which is offered you. It is a ransom to captives, the remission of offenses, the death of sins, the regeneration of the soul, the garment of light, the holy seal indissoluble, the chariot to heaven, the luxury of paradise, a procuring of the kingdom, the gift of adoption." Baptism was also dangerous, and newly baptized Christians were especially vulnerable in times of severe persecution. There are many examples of this, but one of the most notable is that of Perpetua, a 22-year-old married noblewoman who was also a nursing mother. Perpetua was a catechumen when she was arrested and baptized before she was led away to prison to await execution. We are told she was taken from one blood bath, that of giving birth, to another, that of being thrown to the wild beast in the arena at Carthage. How long did this time of preparation last? The apostolic tradition says for 3 years, though this doubtless varied from place to place. Origen, who represents the East, not Rome, tells us that the 3 years of baptismal preparation corresponded with a 3-year lectionary cycle during which the catechumen would be given an overview of the entire Bible. During this time, the catechumen would not be permitted to partake in the Lord's Supper nor in certain other features of common worship. In the meantime, those charged with preparing catechumen for baptism would not only encourage the deepening of spiritual discipline, such as fasting, prayer, scripture reading, acts of mercy toward the needy, and so forth, but they would also monitor the moral behavior and lifestyle of those preparing for baptism. Hippolytus tells us there were certain jobs or professions Christians, including those preparing to enter the church through baptism, could not do. For example, they could not be brothel owners. That shouldn't surprise anybody. There you have it. Pagan priests. Makes sense. But then you get to sculptors, actors, school teachers, soldiers, charioteers, gladiators. Well, being a teacher or a soldier involved swearing an oath to the imperial deity, which Christians saw as a form of idolatry. The catechumenate was a period of liminality, being on the threshold, on the border, as those who were to be baptized waited at the threshold of the church, not unlike the children of Israel, waiting on the banks of the Red Sea with Pharaoh breathing fire down their necks and the way across the dangerous flood not yet provided. Now, if anyone is thinking, "My, Dr. George has gotten this far in the lecture without mentioning the controversial issue of infant baptism, just like a Baptist speaking in a Presbyterian church." Well, I will come back to that issue, let me assure you, in the third of these lectures, which I entitled somewhat whimsically, "How Calvin is Wrong About Baptism and Right About the Lord's Supper." That's not really what that lecture is about. I don't think Calvin was either completely right or completely wrong about either baptism or the Lord's Supper. But I'll be in dialogue, at least with the Calvin tradition, on behalf of some Reformed Baptist in that lecture. We'll talk about this issue. To my best knowledge, the classic exchange which took place about over 50 years ago now between two German New Testament scholars, Joachim Jeremias, who wrote a book called Infant Baptism in the First Four Centuries, and Kurt Aland, did the early church baptize infants, is still worth reading. And I don't know that the historical part of the argument has been advanced very much. There's been a lot of literature written, including a massive new tome by Everett Ferguson from the Restorationist tradition, about 800 pages. It's an important issue. I don't deny that for a minute. But I think it sometimes obscures what I want to focus on in this lecture, especially, and maybe tomorrow the first lecture as well on Luther. And that is that dimension of not for whom or how old must one be or what is the proper mode of baptism, all important questions, but what baptism is, what it does. Tertullian is aware of the practice of infant baptism in Carthage in the late 2nd, early 3rd century. He's against it. He thinks it should not be done, not only for the parvuli, the little ones, he says, but also not for the inupti, the unmarried ones, lest they be tempted into sin and lose the benefit of their baptism. But at the same time, Origen in the East is also aware of infant baptism, and he thinks of it approvingly. So this is not a new debate that we're having about infant versus believer's baptism. But I want to go on to this 12-step process, because I've got to get through this. So now my second of the 12 steps, divestiture. The most common time for baptism in the early church was early Easter Sunday morning, the Easter Vigil, the time of Jesus' resurrection, early in the morning as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week. But it could occur, baptism, in the early church at other times as well, notably at Epiphany, season we're in now, or Pentecost. The last 40 days prior to Resurrection Sunday, which we call Lent, was a time of intense fasting, prayer, and instruction for the soon-to-be-baptized Christians. Sort of like a marathon runner, stretching every nerve, getting the body and mind in tip-top shape for the great race. We know that baptism took place out of doors where there was running or living water, as the Didache puts it in the early 2nd century. But in the time frame we are considering, baptism had intentionally moved indoors as Christians were able to construct church buildings and baptistry buildings of their own. A few of these still survive, including the 3rd century baptistry from Duro Europos in Syria, in eastern Syria, actually, a reconstruction of which can be seen at Yale University Art Gallery. It's an amazing thing to see. There is also a somewhat later octagonal baptistry and baptismal font at the Church of St. Mary in Ephesus. These archaeological sites and artifacts enable us to visualize how the baptismal ceremony unfolded. When Holy Saturday arrived, the Illuminandi, those who were about to be enlightened or illumined, as all those who were to be baptized were now called, were brought to the baptistry, which was divided in the middle by some kind of partition or wall. The women gathered in one part, the men in the other, and one by one they prepared themselves for baptism. The first rubric for baptism found in a late 4th century church order directs that the bishop enter the vestibule of the baptistry and say to the Illuminandi, without commentary or apology, these four words: take off your clothes. No one fainted or got squeamish, because by now they knew, they'd been in training, they knew what was going to happen and why. They were following Jesus Christ, who was crucified naked, following Him from death into life. All that they had prepared for during the long catechumenate was now about to transpire as they stood there naked on the cold floor in a strange building with darkness still enfolding the earth outside on this early, early Easter morning. The Bible does not say that Jesus was baptized in the nude, although He is depicted that way in some of the Roman catacomb paintings. Anyone familiar, however, with the classic Greek sculpture, the tradition of classic Greek sculpture, will be aware of the nude motif, especially in the depiction of the gods and heroes of Greek mythology. But this is the opposite, the Greek ideal of nudity, is the opposite of what nudity means in the Christian baptismal ritual. It signifies not glory and power and physical beauty to be admired, but rather humility, vulnerability, perhaps a return to the innocence of Adam and Eve prior to the fall, and above all, a stripping away of the old self so that a new one could be put on. St. Augustine uses the language of Paul in Colossians 3, 9 through 14 to exhort the baptismal candidates to strip off the old nature symbolized by the old dirty clothes and be clothed with the new. And for women, not only clothing, but also jewelry and hairpins had to be removed so that nothing could come between the body and the water of baptism. That's divestiture. Number three, renunciation. Once all the clothing had been removed, the candidates are brought to the portal of the baptismal chamber, still separated by gender. There they are instructed to turn to the west, the direction in which the sun goes down. I guess it's that way, huh? And to say out loud, "I renounce you, O Satan, and all your works and all your pomp and all your servitude." Cyril of Jerusalem provides a somewhat longer and juicier statement of renunciation. "I renounce you, Satan, you wicked and cruel tyrant. I no longer fear your power. I renounce you, you crafty scoundrel of a serpent. I renounce you, traitor and perpetuator of every crime who inspired our first parents to revolt. I renounce you, Satan, agent and abettor of all wickedness and all your works." Water is the natural abode of the evil one, the Leviathan who lusts to create havoc through storms and floodings and drownings. And so before the Christian enters into this dangerous watery realm, it is important that Satan, the dragon of the seas, as Cyril calls it, be confronted face to face, hence the turning to the west, the direction of darkness. One part of this active renunciation, at least in the Byzantine liturgy, was the ritual of expectoration. You know that wonderful word? It means to spit. Literally spitting in the face of the devil. Well, as we'll see tomorrow, Luther kept a place for the exorcism of Satan in his 1523 revision of the Latin baptismal rite. But this did not remain in Lutheranism for very long, and much less in the Reformed and Puritan and forget the Baptist traditions. I wish it were there. Just recently, the devil has even been kicked out of the baptismal ceremony of the Church of England. Whereas before, the priest would ask, "Do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God?" prompting a reply, "I reject them." There is now no mention of the devil or even sin in the new Anglican baptismal text approved by His Grace, Archbishop Justin Welby. Parents and godparents of infants brought for baptism are simply asked in the new one to reject evil in all its many forms and all its empty promises. Devil's gone. Well, this is said to be more palatable for the East Enders in London, and doubtless it is more palatable for the evil one as well. Number four, association. Having renounced Satan and all his pomp, those who are about to be baptized, the baptizandi they were called, are asked to turn. They've been looking at the west, spitting at the devil. Now they're asked to turn to the east, the direction in which the sun rises, and say, "And I associate myself with Jesus Christ." This turning from west to east is a picture of the basic meaning of metanoia, which does not simply mean turning over a new leaf or having a simple change of mind, but rather a complete redirection of one's life. A radical change of allegiance. We have turned our backs on the devil, and we are walking toward the sunrise, toward the embrace of the risen Savior. I'm going to hurry through these others because I'm not sure I'm keeping correct time here. So number five, confession. One part of this baptismal liturgy was what was called the traditio symboli, that is the handing on of the creed, the symbol. So in theology, symbolics is the discipline that studies the creeds and confessions of the church. The handing on of the symbol, the giving over of the precious creed of the Christian church. And this was done when the creed was recited. Now you get variation. Sometimes it's recited apparently in the water, sometimes before going into the water, and on other times after the actual water part of the baptism. But it is always a part of this baptismal liturgy, this reciting of the creed. It often be done in terms of question. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth? And if you're living in Rome or Carthage, you would say, Credo, I believe. If you live in Jerusalem or somewhere else in the East, Constantinople, you would say, Pistuo, I believe. This was comparable in a way to taking a military oath, because in baptism you were being drafted into the Militia Christi, the army of God. And this was something very common in a military oath, that you were making an allegiance that had a claim upon your life. In Baptist practice today, this has again been reduced. Sometimes the person being baptized says nothing at all. In some Baptist churches, a little bit better ones, the pastor will say, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I baptize you. So at least you get in that profession of faith statement, though not many people really know what that means. But in the really good Baptist churches, the candidates themselves respond by reciting the creed or telling what God has done in their own life. They give a conversion story, or they say some version of the Christian creed. Now, number six, immersion. There were four modes of baptism, and are, I guess, maybe someone could think of a fifth, four, that have been used throughout the history of the church in different ways. Submersion, immersion. It's not real clear what the difference is between those two, although apparently the way some of the early church fathers use the term immersion, they're referring to the priest or the pastor standing above the person in the water and literally putting their head under the water, as opposed to dipping them in the water. These are technicalities we need not spend too much time on. Aspersion and effusion, pouring, sprinkling and pouring. There's a letter from Gregory I written to some Christians in Spain, just at the edge of the patristic beginning of the medieval period. And the question they have asked him that prompted his response was, must Christians always baptize by immersion? And he wrote back and he said that either of the two methods under discussion was okay, but that in Rome, he reported, immersion, triple immersion, was more normally the practice. Why triple immersion? Well, it's a sign, it's an indication both of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but also of the 3 days Christ spent in the grave before the resurrection. There's a wonderful story. I have every reason to believe it's true. I'm a historian, but I believe everything's true. You know, everything I read, I just accept it, unless there's overwhelming evidence that it's not. And there's no overwhelming evidence about this story. It's about Saint Cecilia, who is the saint of musicians, or music players. And the story is that she was martyred in the very act of singing her faith. And when her body was found, brutalized and murdered, there were 3 fingers extended on her corpse, saying that to the very point of martyrdom, she would not deny the Holy Trinity. 7, investiture. We did the divestiture. Let's go the other way now. The investiture. Once these candidates have emerged from the baptismal waters, the candidates are now clothed in white garments called albata, in Latin, from which we get our English word alb, A-L-B. Theodore of Mopsuestia said these are dazzling garments of pure white. The scriptural allusions that are often called forth are things like the noble army of martyrs clothed in white robes, we read about in Revelation 6 and 7, or Jesus at his transfiguration, his countenance became dazzling white, and also wedding garments, for baptism represents a wedding garment to these Christians, putting on a wedding garment, preparing for the coming of the bridegroom. Okay, 8, sealing. This is really important. I've got to rush through it, but sealing. S-E-A-L-I-N-G, sealing. It involved, well, let me just mention 4 things. The main thing was the laying on of hands and the anointing with oil. There were multiple anointings in many of these liturgies and orders, but the anointing could come either before or after the immersion in the water, but the laying on of hands was often reserved for a bishop or some leader of that caliber as a sign of receiving the Holy Spirit. Also, the holy kiss, which of course is referred to in the New Testament. And something else, milk and honey given before the Paschal meal. Milk and honey, of course, is what was provided in the Promised Land. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. And so this Old Testament resonance is picked up again and appropriated in the context of entering into the life of Jesus Christ through baptism. And finally, the sign of the cross. Well, I may say a little bit more about that tomorrow. That's one of the things Martin Luther retains, the sign of the cross. Very often in Reformed and Free Church traditions, it's dropped out completely. Again, to our detriment, I think. Okay, just four more, then I'll stop because we don't have time for that last section tonight. This one may surprise you a little bit. Salination, salt. John the deacon, writing about 500 AD, speaks about the blessed salt that is given as a preservative. And of course, this recalls the words of Jesus right in the Sermon on the Mount. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. Catechumen actually received salt several times during their preparation for baptism. Augustine himself, in the Confessions, Book 1, Section 11, refers to himself being salted. Not at his baptism, but much younger in his early life before he took the step of baptism. 10, illumination. After the chrismation, that's the sealing, the anointing, the laying on of hands, the newly baptized Christians are given lit tapers or torches. Remember, it's still dark usually, and they march from the baptistry into the church. It recalls the parable in Matthew 25, verses 1 through 13, of the virgins going to the wedding feast with their lamps burning. Number 11, pedilavium, that's the washing of the feet. This was more localized. It was not so universal, but I think it's fascinating to me that especially in the liturgy of Milan, where Augustine was baptized, where Ambrose was bishop, in Milan, they retained the practice of the washing of the feet of the newly baptized Christians. If you've just been immersed in water from head to toe, why do you need to have your feet washed again? Well, this symbolized the fact that they are going to walk in a world in which they need this special kind of consecration to remind them that they are following in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. And it is a way also of reminding of overcoming Satan, because remember the curse of Genesis 3:15, the heel is mentioned. Bruise your heel. And so they want that heel that Satan is so interested in. Now, among Baptists, foot washing has been a really controversial issue. There is a denomination of Baptists called the Free Will Baptists that still practice foot washing as a dominical sacrament along with baptism and the Lord's Supper based on John 13. You've seen me do this to you, do also to one another. It's a pretty strong command of Jesus. So they refer to that and they practice foot washing on a regular, ongoing basis as a sacrament. They call it that. And number 12, after all of this had happened in different ways, in different time sequences, the newly baptized Christians would join together with their candles, salt still in their tongues, their feet washed if they were in Milano. And together they come into the assembly where they are welcomed, warmly welcomed. They've recently been anointed. They probably smell pretty good. I say that because during Lent, there was no taking a bath. You couldn't take a bath until just before your baptism. So these people had not been smelling too good for quite a while. But now they have been bathed, anointed, and they walk into the sanctuary, the assembly, and there they are greeted warmly as brothers and sisters in Christ. And for the first time, invited to come and take the body and blood of Jesus Christ, the Eucharist. That was the closing and final completion of the baptismal process. So I think it's better for us to see this not just as a one-time punctiliar event that just happened on a certain moment or day, but rather as a serious process of initiation into the life of faith, into the life of the church, into the life of Jesus Christ. Tomorrow I'll say a little bit about how Luther deals with this. I'm going to do tomorrow what I tell my students never, ever to do. I'm going to speed right through the Middle Ages. Whew. 1,000 years will take place between tonight and tomorrow. And then we will be here to talk about Martin Luther, who lived in a very different context, had some very different ideas, but also drew on this rich baptismal tradition of the early church. Thank you very much for your attention.